pray and thank the Lord for all he has done, for all he still will do in this meeting tonight. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us, that you have given to us a message to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he has transformed so many of our lives in this car park, that he has made us anew, that he has put a new song into our heart. And Father, we thank you for this message that we proclaim, that it is still the power of God unto salvation. We thank you, O God, that this message has been inhibited from going out over these past 18 months in this car park and on YouTube. We praise you, Father, for how you've been taking it, how you've been applying it to lives, how through your Spirit you've been changing lives. And O God, to you be the glory. May your name be honored, that it's not about us, but it's all about you. And so we thank you, Father, from the bottom of our heart, for each Sunday as we met here, for gracing us with your presence, for the very stillness of time, the very stillness some of these meetings have been, when we have felt the very presence of God. And oh, Father, we just return with a heart full of gratitude for all the good things you have done for us. But Lord, we know the end is not yet. We know that you have brought people to this car park tonight, who you have been speaking with, you have been striving with, for over 18 months. And we know that there is a battle going on in their hearts. There's been a stirring, but there's been a battle. Though we pray on this, the final outreach at the bush, they would give you your unhindered way and say, here am I, Lord, take me. God, we realize that you're here. You long to save the sinner, long to set them free from the power of sin and Satan, and bring them into the family of God. Our prayer is, Holy Spirit, won't you come? Won't you teach us more about the Lord Jesus Christ? And may each of our hearts gathered here tonight, might they burn within them as they focus upon him alone. And so we look to you for Gordon as he would sing, for Reverend Maxwell as he speaks. Might it even be a message from you. We look to you alone in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite Gordon from our church in Irvinstown, the Penn Methodist, to come and to bring us two pieces of song. Thank you, Gordon.
I'm a pilgrim.
Singing that piece that I discovered here in my mind that the first two pieces that I've chosen are both about following. And life is a matter of following. It's a matter of a journey. And the journey of life has brought you to where you are today. And that may have been a pleasant journey or it may not have been a pleasant journey. We have many experiences in life that we don't like. Things have happened to you over the journey of life, but you're here tonight. You have a journey in front of you if the Lord spares you. And where is that journey taking us is the question. We've been born into this world, and that was a question that puzzled me from I was young. I remember walking, I don't remember whether it was home from school or to school, it was on the road anyway, and wondering to myself, why on earth was I born? What was the purpose of it all? Maybe you have questions like that. But the Bible gives us the answer. It tells us that we are on a journey, and it tells us of one that we can accept into our lives that will bring us safely to that eternal home, which is where the Lord wants us to be. A little piece here again about the journey of life.
The life is a journey in search of a land. The pathway so often is not a
when you say
to come without it. Your life is empty, and you hopelessly stand. Just live for the touch of the Master's strong hand. Oh, I feel the touch of
have been a time of change, haven't they? Many things have changed in our world. Many people that would have been with us at the drive-in have went on to be with the Lord. And this, as we look back over 18 months, as I said, it brings change. But there is one that changes not, and it is the Lord Jesus Christ, and His salvation changes not. And I encourage you, if you've been coming to these meetings, and there's been a stirring in your heart, and you know for some time that it's time to become a Christian, then I really urge you from the bottom and depths of my soul to wait behind. To contact us, our mobile, our numbers are on the sheet. Let us pray with you. Let us direct you to the one who never changes, and the one who wants to set you free from sin and from Satan, and to give you eternal salvation. And so that invitation is open to you. And we encourage you, those who the Lord has been speaking to do that while there is still time. Again, we do want to thank you so much, each one of you who have faithfully been with us. Many of you Sunday after Sunday, whether that was at 3:30 in the afternoon or whether that was at 6:30, we deeply appreciate it that you set time aside to come out and to support the work of God. And by you being here, you've encouraged the person preaching, and you've encouraged the person singing, but most importantly, as we've joined as a community, we've been able to glorify God as one body. And so thank you so much for standing with us during this very difficult time, and for giving to us even your attention and time during the meetings. We want to give a special thank you to John and Joyce Irwin. If we didn't have a lorry trailer, well, we certainly would have been wet tonight. But we want to give them a very big thanks. Also for Paul and Jennifer, for the use of their yard, and for Jimmy for tidying up and setting out, and Trevor Ferguson and his Reverend Maxwell has stated this morning that on behalf of yourself, there will be a presentation made to them privately. Remember then our gospel mission, which will be commencing on the 14th of November, with the evangelist John Weir. We are anticipating this. We're looking forward to it. We believe that God has something special for this week of meetings. And in preparation, we are going to be having special times of prayer. We believe in prayer. We believe in the power of prayer. And that is why tomorrow we'll be having a prayer meeting in the church hall at 8 p.m. Then on Tuesday at 10:30 a.m. will be a Zoom prayer meeting. And then on Wednesday at 8 p.m. will be our prayer meeting and Bible study. So do take mention. Take note of those meetings. Then on Thursday will be our ladies' meeting in the sanctuary whenever at 8 p.m. whenever Philippa Parker will be sharing. Friday at Lifeliners at 7 p.m. Also, men and also ladies, we'll be having a clean up just around the church on Saturday morning at 9:30. And perhaps you could spare even an hour, or to even come at 10 o'clock, whatever you can spare to come and just to clean a few things up for the harvest. And for the mission, we would greatly appreciate that. That's at 9:30, we'll commence that. Then on Saturday, the Haven is at 8 p.m. Whenever Danny Brooks will be speaking to us and Simon Emerson will be singing to the young people. And so do make sure and share that post whenever you see it out on Facebook and Instagram, and let other young people know about these meetings. It's going to be a time just of blessing, and the Lord will come down and meet with our young people. Lives will be challenged and transformed through these meetings. We believe that. And so do invite others to join us. Then do make mention of our, and then 11:30 is our morning service. Do make mention of our new time for our evening service. Is at 6:30 p.m., whenever John Porter will be singing to us. And a group of our own young people will also be singing. So you'll not want to miss that. That's at 6:30. And also that the back hall will be open for those who are shielding. There also will be a time of prayer in the lower hall at 6 p.m. At 5:45 p.m. if you can join us for that, at 5:45 just in the lower hall. We're going to sing together again before Gordon comes to sing to us, and then Reverend Maxwell to bring us God's word. Come to the Saviour, make no delay.
Sorry, the next verse is enough.
the judgment overtakes you, when your soul has taken flight, you remember how you answered, "I'll get saved, but not tonight." Then will come the time, O sinner, when you stand upon the brink, when your soul is lost forever, without Christ, you sadly see. So give me just a little longer, for the world it seems so bright. When I feel that I am dying, I'll just stay, but not tonight. Give me just a little longer, for the world it seems so bright. When I feel that I am dying, I'll just say, "Don't come tonight."
Thank you very much, Gordon, for those lovely messages and song this evening. We deeply appreciate you coming and sharing with us this evening, and trust that God will indeed bless his word to all of our hearts as we turn to it in a little moment. Again, just to reiterate what Pastor Samuel has already said, we're so glad to see you. And we thank sincerely all who have come so regularly. We deeply appreciate it. And thank you for coming. And may the Lord bless you. Do feel free to join us in there at the church in Mogashal at 6:30 next Sunday evening. It'd be lovely to see you indeed. So we want to just read a few verses of scripture from the Acts of the Apostles 26, Acts chapter 26, and Paul speaking to Agrippa said, "Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. For these causes the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, witnessing both to small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles." And as he thus spake for himself, Festus said with a loud voice, "Paul, thou art beside thyself, much learning doth make thee mad." And he said, "I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak forth the words of truth and soberness, for the king knoweth of these things, before whom also I speak freely, for I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him, for this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know thou believest." And Agrippa said unto Paul, "Almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian." Amen. And we know the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his own infallible and holy word. Let's just bow for a moment's prayer. Father, we thank you for all that we have heard in the hymns and choruses and the songs from Gordon. And our Father, we pray now that as we turn to your word, that your word indeed would bear fruit in hearts and lives even tonight. Help me, gracious God, I pray in Jesus' name, and for his glory alone we ask it. Amen. You would think that Gordon and I had been speaking together about the subject that I'm going to speak on tonight, whenever he sang that last piece. But I can assure you we had no contact with each other along those lines whatsoever. But it just fits in with what we want to share tonight. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Almost is one of the saddest words that anybody can utter. It's in keeping, it keeps company with the expression like, if only, if only. How many people reiterate those words? If only such and such a thing had happened. Friends, I don't want you to be saying in eternity, if only I had given my life to Christ during those drive-in meetings in Cranston's yard. I don't want anybody to feel like that when it comes to eternity. In this passage, three different men are mentioned. There's Festus, there's Paul, and there's King Agrippa. And each of those men represent a different attitude toward the Lord Jesus. Festus represented a man who was hating the Lord. He was antagonistic to the message. He said to Paul, thou art mad. He had no thought or no consideration for God or for the things of God. Then Paul the Apostle, of course, was the opposite. He had embraced the gospel. He had come to Christ. He was born again of the Spirit of God. And then, of course, does this man, Agrippa, represents those who are undecided concerning eternal matters. An almost Christian is still not saved. Almost persuaded because of what he knew. That's the first thought. Almost persuaded because of what he knew. What brought Agrippa to this place of being almost persuaded to be a Christian? Agrippa had a bad background, really. His grandfather, Herod the Great, killed all the baby boys are there at Bethlehem at the time of the birth of Christ. Then his uncle, this man's uncle, Herod Antipas, he beheaded John the Baptist. And his father, Herod Agrippa, was the one who killed James, the disciple. So he had a very bad category in his background. He was a man who had a lot of bad influences on his life. But somehow this man, after listening to the amazing testimony of this man Paul, and we haven't time to read that, but you read from the beginning of the chapter 26 of the Acts, when you go home, and you read the amazing testimony of Paul the Apostle. And this man, after listening to Paul, after listening to this great man of God give his testimony, it had a tremendous impact upon him. Agrippa knew the scriptures. It tells us that verse 26. And 27, for the king knoweth these things, before whom also I speak freely. For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him. For this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? Speaking of the Old Testament prophets. And he says, I know that thou believest. I know that you believe. So Paul here reminds Agrippa of the word of God in his background. And we know that King Agrippa had some exposure to truth. We don't know how much, but he had some, according to Paul. Paul reminds the king of his background about how he had been converted, and also how he had known about the prophets. But Paul goes further and reminds Agrippa that he not only knows these things, but he believes them. He believes them because he believed what the prophets of the Old Testament said. In verse 27, King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? And Paul answered it for him and says, I know you believe. I know you believe. What things did the prophets say? That a lamb would be brought, and that it sacrificed in the Old Testament sacrificial offerings that were made, pointing to the Lamb of God, and that the crucifixion of Christ was quite fresh in the minds of these people at this time. This remarkable man, Jesus Christ, had been crucified. And so here we have this remarkable story of Christ's death on the cross. And the resurrection was proof that Jesus was the Lamb of God, because he had risen from the dead. And that was something that didn't happen every day. That was something absolutely wonderful. It proved the deity of Jesus. It proved he was the Son of God, because he rose from the dead. That without forgiveness of sin, people would remain under Satan's rule and would never see heaven. That wonderful inheritance that's spoken about in verse 18 of this chapter. It says that Jesus came to open the eyes of the blind and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Speaking of a great salvation. Friends, tonight we have been preaching over these months here in this yard and many other places of this great salvation. Our friend, it's a wonderful message, the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's actually 50 years ago this weekend since I left to go to Bible college. That's a long time. And you know, friends, I wouldn't change anything that has happened over those years in preaching the glorious message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's such a powerful message. It's such a wonderful truth to share. And friends, I'm glad that I have had this opportunity to share with you this evening the message that made Agrippa almost persuaded to be a Christian. Agrippa knew there was reality in Paul's testimony. As I said, these early verses are all about Paul's testimony. And he knew the reality. Oh, friends, you say, oh, well, I know people and I don't see much reality about their Christianity. But listen a moment. You also know people, and there is a mark upon their lives. They are decisively different. God has done something for them. God has saved them by his marvelous grace. And here's this man Agrippa, convinced by the testimony of the Apostle Paul that he was come to the place where he was almost persuaded to be a Christian. Paul is saying, it's not only you who has a history of sin and a background of opposing the truth, but it's for everyone to come to Christ and find this great salvation. Isn't there something powerful about the personal testimony of someone who's powerfully changed by the gospel? Maybe you know somebody and they have been speaking to you perhaps, maybe speaking to you recently about being saved, and you've got to acknowledge that that is a genuine person. You know why they try to witness and speak to you? Because they love you and they don't want to see you lost. They want to see you in heaven. And that's why Paul the Apostle takes this amazing opportunity to speak to this man Agrippa. Oh, friends, it's a wonderful truth, the truth that Jesus saves. Agrippa knew of Jesus because Paul tells him that these things were not done in a corner. Of course he knew about the crucifixion. Who didn't know about it? Of course he knew the reality of what happened in the resurrection morning when Christ rose from the dead. You know that Jesus died on the cross and that he rose from the dead to forgive you, friend, your sin. Just as Agrippa knew all those years ago. Can you comprehend the truth that everything Jesus endured, the nails in his hands and his feet, the whip on his back, the spittle of the people into his very face, the beating, the cruel mockery. Why did such a thing happen? Because Jesus loved you, and because Jesus died for you, that you might have eternal life. That's why, friends. That's why we tell out this great message that Jesus saves. Just almost persuaded because of Satan's power. Just almost persuaded because of Satan's power. If it hadn't been for the power of Satan and the impact that Satan had on this man's life, he'd have been saved. Can I say something, friends? If it hadn't been for the influence of Satan in your life, you'd be saved as well. But he's pumping all the nonsense of the day into your mind to keep you back from coming to Christ. He is indeed, friends. Agrippa heard some persuasive arguments. Agrippa was not just sitting there unmoved. His heart was stirred. Imagine the king saying, "Almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian." That was no soft answer coming, and Festus sitting in the same room who had already condemned the Apostle Paul and said he was mad. But Agrippa, from an honest heart, admitted that he was almost at that point. He saw Paul. He felt his sincerity. He believed his words. He knew he had to make a decision. But whispering in his ear was the old devil, trying to turn him away from this most important decision in his life. When God speaks, friend, I can assure you, the devil speaks as well. When God speaks, the devil speaks. Satan used different tactics. He uses different tactics to different people. And he allows people to come to an almost position As long as they don't come to Christ, he doesn't mind. As long as people keep putting it off, then the devil's happy enough. But when you get sincere and definite about the matter, that's when the area of conflict comes in. Ah, yes, this man loved his sin. He was living with Bernice, this woman, in an immoral relationship. And if he got converted, there'd have to be changes. His love for his sin caused him to stop at almost. One of the keys to salvation is repentance. And repentance, friend, is turning away. Turning away from your sin. Would to God, friend, you would turn away from sin and turn to Christ even this evening. The price he would have to pay, Satan caused fear. Fear of the cost. Notice how he did that with Agrippa. He made Agrippa afraid of the people. Agrippa was king. Why would he need to be afraid, you would think? But Agrippa was a proud man. And he, if he professed faith in Christ, his Jewish subjects and his Roman superiors would have turned on him like a pack of wolves. He would have lost his position in society. Do you think, friend, if you came to Christ, that somehow people wouldn't think as much of you? Friend, don't worry about what people think about you. Because it's an irrelevance, really, what people think about us. It's what God thinks about us that's all important. The Roman governor Festus, in the room here, as I've already said, perhaps it is, friend, the fear of friends or family that keeps you back from coming to Christ. How many times people have been hindered because they weren't prepared to acknowledge their sin. Henry Ironside, the preacher, was just a young boy. He wasn't a Christian. His mother talked to him about becoming a Christian. He would always tell his mother, "Mother, I would really like to, but I'm afraid of what my friends would, that my friends would laugh at me." His mother would always say, "Remember, Harry, your friends may laugh you into hell, but they'll never laugh you out." That's solemn, but it is serious. The devil makes Agrippa afraid of the immediate future. Agrippa is afraid of the immediate future. Paul was chained because of his relationship with Jesus. He was a prisoner. Agrippa could see that it could cost him to come to Christ. Can I say, friend, that in other countries of the world, some Muslim countries, communist countries, people do pay a very high price for coming to Christ, even their very lives. But friends, they're prepared to do it because they know the value of salvation, and they're coming to Christ in quite good numbers of people in different parts of the world. Almost persuaded because of what he knew, or just almost persuaded because of Satan's power, and almost persuaded, but not persuaded. Almost persuaded, but not fully persuaded. The American Olympic swimmer Tim McKee is often remembered for being a part of the closest Olympic swimming finishing in history. On the 30th of August 1972, He missed gold by 200th of a second. He almost won, but he missed it. Almost won, but he missed it. Many's the one almost passed an exam, but missed it. Friend, I don't want you to miss salvation. Almost will affect others. Think of others looking on in your life that you could influence toward God if only you got saved. Oh, friend, don't be almost, but be altogether persuaded, such as I am, such as Pastor Samuel is. Almost will not do, friend. You need to be altogether persuaded. Almost means lost. Means altogether lost. He almost came to Jesus, but one day death took him. And as far as we know, there's no record of this man coming to Christ. He missed it. He was lost because he missed salvation. His almost was not good enough. Maybe you say, I'm a good person. Well, friend, if you don't accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me, all ye that work iniquity. Wouldn't it be awful if Jesus was to say that to you on that final day? The rich young ruler was almost converted, but turned away. The lost thief on the cross was almost, well, he was in the very presence of death. And one, his comrade, turned to Christ and was saved, but he wasn't. Judas Iscariot was 3 years with Jesus, but was lost. Felix, he heard the gospel, and he said, some other convenient day, I'll call. Friends, don't wait for another convenient day. Come tonight. Trust Christ. I have some little booklets in my pocket. It says, let him in, a lovely little booklet explaining how you can let the Master into your life to save you by his marvelous grace. May God bless you. And we'll just have one verse of our closing hymn, Almost Persuaded.
Nights they've been having in their bed. You know, the wrestling they've been having while they've been sitting on the couch. And Lord, you've brought them to a moment in their life when you're asking them to come out and to say, I'll not be almost persuaded, but I'll be altogether persuaded that he is the Savior and he will be my Savior. Oh God, we pray you'll be merciful. We ask you'll continually convict with sin. And Lord, that even today there will be people converted to the gospel. Oh God, we thank you again for your speaking voice. We thank you for everyone represented. We pray your blessing and favor may rest upon every home. And we ask this for your name's sake. Amen. As Reverend Maxwell said, do stop if you feel God has been speaking to you. And do take one of those little booklets, and that they will be a help to you. Amen, and God bless you.